Larry, first of all, thanks so much. After you were last here, you had some health problems, but you're out of the woods. You're all good now, and we're glad to see you.
Never better. To quote my favorite author, or one of them anyway, was it, reports of my demise are greatly exaggerated.
Well, we're glad for that. We're
Thank
glad
you,
for
Jim.
That. Larry, there's no arguing that the economic growth rate, 4.1%, is a positive for the country. And you have said that you agree with the president that this is sustainable. There are some economists who are skeptical, and I just want to read some of what they had to say. The chief economist at Moody's said the growth we're seeing is not sustainable and will come close to stalling out by 2020. The chief economist at Morgan Stanley said that this is the growth is a result of doomsday prepping. In the New York Times, she said, quote, global companies are stockpiling raw materials, intermediate goods, and finished goods before tariffs take effect and raise the prices of those goods. Once the bite of tariffs hits demand, companies will no longer need to build inventories, and this boost to economic growth could end. Why are you so confident it is sustainable?
Well, there's just a lot of good things going on. I appreciate that my profession may disagree. They often do. But look, policies matter a lot, Jake, and I think the president deserves a victory lap. Low tax rates, rolling back regulations, opening up energy, for example, trade reform, which I think is already paying off with respect to the EU agreement we did last week. Fundamentals of the economy look really good. You know, just parsing through some of these numbers, the 4.1% quarter, inventories very low, cap goods booming, business investment spending really booming. That's a productivity creator. That's a job creator. That's a wage creator for ordinary Main Street folks. Terribly important. In fact, the saving rate was revised higher by $500 billion. That gives consumers plenty of ammunition. And as I say, as Mr. Trump has made it very clear that he intends to reward success, he's not trashing businesses. Mm-hmm. He wants people to just take a rip at the ball. You're seeing the results of these new policies. Now, we've got five Trump quarters. Just under 3%, 2.9%. This was 4.1. The first half was 3.1. I don't see any reason why we can't run this for several quarters again in technical terms. Rock bottom inventories and a capital goods investment boom from business. Those are very strong factors.
I want to get to both trade and the EU deal that you talked about. But before I do, I would be remiss if I didn't point out that this week the Office of Management and Budget just came out with a projection that the budget deficit will reach $1 trillion in 2019. That's $101 billion more than had been previously projected. Republicans control the White House, the House, the Senate. Is President Trump ever going to try to reduce the deficit?
Yes, of course. Look, the effects of this economic growth boom going to be a major important factor to this, very important. The single most
right now it's
thing.
Raising the deficit, though. Right well, now the tax cuts are raising the deficit.
Sometimes in the short run, you know, in order to invest in the economy, lower tax rates do yield lower revenues. I reckon it'll take us a year, maybe 18 months to start turning that around. It's not unusual. I look at it as a good investment in America's future prosperity and healthy economy.
So ultimately, you think it will be deficit neutral, if not reducing the deficit?
You know, some of the numbers I've seen, heaven forbid, even the CBO, they're suggesting we've already paid for 2/3 of the corporate tax cut. I think that by the end of this fiscal year, fiscal year 19, mm-hmm. the corporate tax cut will be paid for. By 2020, it will be more than paid for. And of course, we inherited a tough deficit situation. Anytime you have slow growth, I mean, the prior administration had a very slow growth period, okay, that really damages the budget deficit.
They were coming off the Great Recession of 2008.
And by the way, I give them that, always yeah. have, but not 8 years. I mean, that was the problem. They never got the snapback we should have gotten. I don't want to waste our time on
right.
the policies. You got a new sheriff in town with more incentives to invest.
Let's talk about the sheriff and his plans.
I do want to say, for Mick Mulvaney, our budget director, and President Trump, we are going to be tougher and tougher on spending. Okay? Tougher and tougher on spending. That's part of the deficit calculation, as you well know. So I believe a combination of faster economic growth over the next bunch of years, Jake, mm-hmm. as well as much tougher on spending, so get that deficit on a downer.
Let's talk about trade. Before you became the president's top economic advisor, you wrote in an essay, quote, tariff hikes are really tax hikes. The president this week tweeted in part, quote, tariffs are the greatest. As a philosophical discussion, are tariffs great?
You know, if they're targeted, for good purpose as per China? I think the answer is absolutely yes. That's always been my view. Most free traders agree. China has not played by the rules, and the trading system is broken, largely because of them. Now, I hope we get to our EU trade deal. Let me say this. President has adopted a view with which I completely agree. He's a free trader, and he wants to have no tariffs.
No tariffs at all.
And no non-tariff barriers, and no subsidies. Now, that's a goal, but I think that was part of our EU discussion. That's his view in general. That is also my view. So I think he's gaining. This is a tough, hard thing to do. You know, people say, well, President Trump's tariffs are damaging this, that, and the other thing. I say, don't blame President Trump. He inherited a completely broken world trading system, including a World Trade Organization, most particularly China, but not only China, okay? He's trying to fix it. Other U.S. presidents in both political parties, Dems and Republicans, even-handed, right, have never pushed the way he's pushing. And he believes, and I agree, if we can work these things out and improve the trading system, it will be to the benefit of the United States economy, our exports, our farmers, our industry. And by the way, it will probably help the rest of the world, too. So you just got to give him a chance to get this policy in place.
It seems as though people like farmers are giving him a chance, although they say we want trade, not aid, the $12 billion
and
that
I agree.
Projected.
And I told
they don't
I
want that. They want open markets,
yes,
so they can sell their goods.
And so does POTUS on this. He absolutely wants to open markets. As I said, China, the worst offender. Point here, the deal we made with the European Union this past week is very important to get us on this road.
Let me talk about that specifically.
And Mexico is coming.
Let me talk about the EU, because there is this deal on paper to agree. Critics say that all the President Trump accomplished with this deal were to get things that were already on the table, as you know, during the Obama administration, including negotiations on the what's something called, that our viewers might not have heard of, the TTIP, which is basically a potential trade deal with the European Union. Mm-hmm. Take a look what the president of the National Foreign Trade Council said, quote, most of this deal, the stuff that you worked on with President Trump with the EU this week, most of the deal is stuff we were already on the verge of agreeing on in the TTIP negotiations before that deal got deep-sixed after Trump's election. Your comment.
Well, I'm not sure about that. I don't want to get hung up on that, the Atlantic trading deal. There are a lot of issues with that. I didn't even want to go back there. Look, EU President Juncker and President Trump got together, surprised probably almost everybody in the world, and basically came to agreement on a number of key items. I mean, look at if the deal works through nicely, and it's going to be several stages, I don't think there'll be steel tariffs for the European Union. I don't think there'll be automobile tariffs. I don't want to get ahead of it, but the president indicated.
That's not in the deal right now, though, but you're saying long-term.
It was discussed. And actually, there was a line in this carefully crafted final statement that suggests that would be the case. Europeans came, by the way, right at the top with an offer to purchase tons and tons of American soybeans. They don't have tariffs on them. They just said, we will buy them from you. This is a contentious issue because of China's soybean tariffs, and that's to the point you made earlier. Our farmers would prefer trade, not aid, but they've been stuck. I think soybean prices have already started to firm up in the commodity markets. They want a big LNG deal, liquefied natural gas, want very much. The EU does not want to have to do business with Russia. They'd rather do business with the USA. In fact, they suggested to us that they would find ways and means to have us build or help them build pipelines for LNG. So these are all major steps forward. I wouldn't say it replicates anything because things have been a little bumpy.
Right.
Now all of a sudden we're on the right path. I like that very much.
Stay healthy. We need you back on the show sometime soon,
and
your family and your friends love you and we're worried about you. Thanks for being here. Appreciate it.